There's just so much going on with everybody in and out of the hospitals.
All right, good evening, welcome to the Newmarket Planning Board meeting. I'd like to start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. First on the agenda is public, oh, before we start, Peter, you are going to be appointed this evening to take Jane's place, and Dale is filling in for Amy Burns. All righty, and on to public comments. Anybody have any public comments on anything that's not on the agenda? Hearing none, we will close the public comments. Next is review and approval of the minutes of June 14th. Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes as written, and I'd like to thank Diane and Sue for these minutes.
You're certainly welcome. Our pleasure.
Is there a second?
A second.
Seconded by Peter. Any discussion, comments, corrections? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed say nay.
I think I'm abstaining. I don't think I was here.
You were not here.
You were not.
And
as,
yeah,
well,
have,
but you're showing.
It says you were here.
I know, but I don't think
you were,
I was.
She was not
you
here.
Were not here. Okay, we'll have that correction
later. Before we get started.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
I see some people here for the Industrial Park project. Maybe we could do the continuations.
Yeah.
So that people can have to hang around. It's a suggestion.
Is that the? Okay, is there anybody here that's here for the Industrial Park project as an abutter or anything? You, sir? Okay, those are going to be continued this evening. They're not going to be heard. I'll give you a heads up so you won't have to sit around.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Night.
All right.
We have to make a motion to continue it.
When we get to them, we will.
Okay.
I just want to give him a heads up.
All right.
I'd rather have him sit here for who knows how long. Okay, next on the agenda is Jarob M. Sanderson, Robin Realty, Newmarket Trust, Tuck Realty Corp., continuation of a public hearing for an application for a special use permit at 36 Dame Road, tax map U2, lot 297 in Bay Road, tax map U2, lot 320, both in the R1 zone. The two lots total approximately 28 acres. The proposal is for an 11-lot open space subdivision with septic and wells, leaving approximately 21 acres of open space. So, since our last meeting, there was a site walk that I was not able to attend, and I understand that there was a technical review committee meeting.
There was.
Would you want to fill us in on that, Diane?
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. We did have a technical review committee on June 30th, and just to recognize the TRC members, Roseanne Quox, Val Shelton, and Jane Ford participated in that. And we had a very productive meeting with the applicant's representative and the applicant's engineer. And we went through, we have a checklist that we've created for special use permits based on what's in the ordinance. So we can go down through and make sure all of the conditions and requirements of the town under that section of the ordinance are addressed. And it's sort of a work in progress, and as information comes in, I update it and get it back to the committee members. We spent a good amount of time discussing the yield analysis and went through all of the calculations as defined in the ordinance. We also looked at the general criteria for an open space residential design development and made determinations as to whether or not the TRC felt that the application fit the criteria. And all that documentation is in the planning office, and you're welcome to review it. We also looked at the calculations for open space to make sure that the proposal met the open space requirements, and spent a lot of time going through the calculations, fine-tuning them, and making sure that we were all in agreement with the methodology, which I think by the end of our process, we came to the conclusion that the application did meet those requirements. So what I've done is I put together a memorandum on behalf of the TRC committee, sort of outlining the findings of fact based on our technical review process. And also, I do want to mention that the yield plan that was created called for the creation of 11 lots, and the applicant was able to claim an additional density bonus to allow one additional lot because more than 50% of the open space was considered to be developable lands, which is an opportunity for an additional 10% above and beyond what the yield analysis provides. The conservation land analysis indicated that there would be a requirement for open space, and the applicant well exceeded that amount, providing 21 acres of open space. And let me just, to give you an overview, our calculations showed 18.8 acres, and they exceeded the amount. So all of the calculations indicated that they were consistent with the terms of the ordinance, and therefore the TRC committee felt comfortable in recommending the 11 units and the 21 acres of open space, of which, by the way, over 63% is considered developable, whereas 50% is the threshold for the extra bonus. So with that, there's a recommendation coming forward to you this evening to approve the special use permit application and to approve the yield calculations, the yield plan, and the open space calculations. There are some conditions of approval that I'd like to briefly go over, if I could, Mr. Chairman. One, that as part of this process, that all easement documents and deeds pertaining to the open space and any drainage structures which will be provided and best management practices to be reviewed and approved by the town's legal counsel. That number two, a land stewardship plan be provided in a narrative form professionally prepared by an appropriate environmental consultant, which focuses on the long-term management of the open space and how it will be maintained over time. Number three, that suitable provisions and plans be provided for trail access for the public to be incorporated into the final subdivision plans, and that with this in hand, that the applicant come forward with an application for a subdivision plan that meets all the remaining requirements in the town's subdivision regulations for residential open space developments. And with that, if the committee members would like to add anything to the review.
Is there anybody in the public that's here to speak relative to this project? Come on up, ma'am. Please, just give us your name and address, please.
My name is Melissa Sharple, so I'm in a butter on the back side. My address is 8 Boardman Ave. And we had talked about this initially when you first came in a couple of months ago. One of my primary concerns is the third condition, actually, that you just mentioned, which is the plans for trail access. That trail basically is my backyard. And I think one of the original mentions that you had was signage and basically pointing everybody to that area. Right now, I've found things back, you know, there's beer cans and fire pits and I find different things at different times. My concern is, you know, advertising that as a right-of-way is A, going to diminish my property, and B, just make it a little bit more hazardous out there. So there's a lot of wildlife. I've got about 30 turkeys in my yard right now. So that's my primary concern based on what's been mentioned here today.
Excuse me, one question.
Sure.
The beer cans and stuff, are they're in your backyard?
Well, it's not on my property.
Right behind your property.
My land abuts the stream.
Yeah.
That runs on the bottom side of that hill. So, you know, there's a path back there now that, you know, the kids are back there.
It's in your backyard, but it's not your backyard.
Yeah, you know, it's visible, and so I just don't want it to get any bigger. I have a couple of other things, but they weren't mentioned, so I'll wait.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Mention them now.
Well, I mean, they may have even been addressed because we talked about it initially, but one of my concerns is the lighting and how that was going to work, whether it was just going to be one main street light at the entry at Dame Road, whether there was going to be planted lighting on the road, how my backyard is going to light up.
That has yet to be determined yet.
Right.
That is part of the subdivision application.
Okay.
Which we will review subsequent, in the future.
I can say, at a minimum, the Public Works Director typically likes to see some kind of light at the access point.
Yep.
In order for police and fire rescue.
Yeah.
Emergency vehicles to be able to locate the road.
That's understandable.
It's a dark rural road.
Yeah, it is.
So it's really, you know, for public safety reasons.
Okay.
Other issues related to lighting we'll talk about, and you're welcome to attend our TRC meetings and join us.
Okay.
And watch the progress of those discussions.
Great. Thank you.
Anybody else in public have anything to add? Does the applicant have anything to add that they think is important for our deliberation on this?
I just wanted to make note that I did speak with several of the abutters the first time I appeared before the board, and we weren't quite ready to discuss the application at that meeting. I think it was in May or whenever it was. And so we had a chance to meet with, I think I met with four or five of the neighbors, and we did talk about the public access that we had proposed. We have since taken that off the plans, but in the discussions at the site walk and at TRC, I think the recommendations are clear that, at least from the TRC standpoint, that public access is something that would be encouraged. And we would just defer to the board. We'll do it. It doesn't have to be marked. We're not proposing to do a you know, parking area or anything like that, but just to maintain it as a 20-foot, you know, easement for public to access the trail. And
yes, and that'll be taken up during the subdivision.
Sure. So I just wanted to be clear that we've had discussions with both, you know, neighbors and with TRC, and just want to make sure that we're clear about that. And just, I know we'll discuss it later, but as far as lighting goes, we'll do whatever DPW wants for the street light, and then we're not proposing any lights within the subdivision. So other than that, I don't have anything else to add.
Okay. Thank you.
I did want to mention that we have an additional piece of documentation from the applicant. One of the requirements for the open space development and for review and approval of the yield plan is we need to have assurance that the project is envisioned as a conventional subdivision is marketable. And the applicant has provided us with a statement from Nate Dickey, who is with Keller Williams Realtor, indicating that it's his opinion, professional opinion, that the yield plan is economically realistic and therefore would meet that criteria of the open space requirements.
Okay, thank you, Diane. Do any board members have any questions of the applicant?
Basically, as far as the trail goes, I think once you have homes there with people's backyards backing up to it, and especially if you put signage first, sunset, you know, with restrictions like we do abutting our property, you're probably going to end up having less of the beer cans and more people, you know, there for nature hikes and such like that. That's what we found on our property. So I think once the development's in, you're going to have less problems.
There's a reason for keeping it in.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, I'll just speak from having done the site walk and actually accessing both trails. So we took the site walk out through on what would be particularly a conventional subdivision, and there's a maintained trail that some abutter must be using with an ATV that comes out to Lamprey Street, kind of near the applicant property, is in the old ice pond. And then we walked back along the stream bed over what I think the abutter's referring to as a trail that goes out to Dame Road. And when we walked that, it was very much unused, unmaintained, overgrown.
Sure.
And, you know, so that isn't being utilized currently, but the other trail is. And so we envision, I think from the TRC's perspective, for those of us on the sidewalk, the best connectivity would be for this subdivision, somewhere off the cul-de-sac, to be able to, for the people in the subdivision, or along Dame Road in that area, to come through the subdivision and then access Lamprey Street over by Dice Pond, not Boardman. It's the closest end to town, and we can come down through and go through the mill yard and get into town. It's a short walk.
The other thing to note, too, is that trail is located on the eastern side, easterly side of that stream, that brook that runs through. So there's a good 100 or so feet between neighboring property lines, more like 150 feet or so in that trail. And those beer cans were not from our sidewalk. So.
Oh, come on up again if you have any question.
Sure. Were you referring to access? I just want to make sure access to Lamprey Street as a walking trail.
Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
We're not talking a road, an extra road.
Does any other board members have any questions or comments?
For Diana, for the applicant.
Ezra, go ahead.
I was just wondering about, in terms of the mostly second, but the second, third condition, in terms of, like, so submitting a land stewardship plan and narrative form, what is the kind of provisions or process for ensuring that it's sufficient? Or as opposed, this just talks about them preparing it. And I guess I don't know if we're just relying on it professionally prepared, or if there's other parts where we see that, or if the Conservation Commission might.
We sometimes ask the Conservation Commission to weigh in, and it typically is like the last time we did an open space development, we had a compliance hearing after we received the final product, and in that case they were turning the land over to the Southeast Land Trust, but we were able to have a review of it and critique it and make changes. And so, you know, it was a process that where the Planning Board had some input as well as Conservation Commission. And I think everybody felt pretty comfortable at the end of the day with the terms of it.
Your Conservation Commission chairman was on that site walk with us. I believe it was the chairman. And we...
He's here.
I think we talked about, you know, periodic mowing of the meadow so that we wouldn't interfere with wild, you know, the birds and others, animals that might, live in that vicinity of the property. So we were talking about once a year mowing. That'll be part of the stewardship plan. We definitely would be happy to work with the CONCOM and or any other groups to kind of fine-tune that plan once we draft it.
And so just to clarify, so this language would allow for us to have that review?
Yes. Okay. Most definitely. Okay. If you'd like it, we can include that as an explicit condition of the approval.
Any other comments from the board, questions? Anybody in the public, again, want to speak? That I will close the public hearing at 7:20. What's the pleasure of the board?
Motion.
Absolutely.
Make a motion to approve the application of Jared M. Sanderson, Robin Realty, Newmarket Trust, / Tuck Realty Corp. at 36 Dame Road, Tax Map U2, Lot 297, and Bay Road, Tax Map U2, Lot 320, for a special use permit for residential open space design development pursuant to the authority granted under Section 6.01 of the Newmarket Zoning Ordinance for property to permit construction of 11 single-family homes based on the findings of fact within the letter from the town planner dated July 7th, 2016, and including the letter from Keller Williams Coastal Realty under Section 6 of those findings of facts dated 7/11/16, and with the conditions as noted in the planner's memo. With the following amendment to number 4, that the applicant provide a complete application for subdivision plan which meets the requirements of the town subdivision regulations, including those in Section 314, residential open space design, in which conforms, this is what I'm adding, in which conforms to the findings of fact and conditions of approval for this special use permit.
Second.
That will tie in your issue, Ezra.
What was that last part, Dale, which conforms?
In which conforms to the findings of fact and conditions of approval for this special use permit.
Okay, is there any other discussion? Oh, is there a second, actually?
I second.
Seconded, Rosie. Any discussion?
So this is to approve all 11?
Just special use permit.
Special use permit.
To be able to do an open space subdivision.
To be able to do the sub, to be able to submit 11-unit subdivision.
Correct.
Correct, yep. Any other questions, comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed?
Opposed.
Opposed? Peter, for the record, Peter opposed the vote. Motion passes. Thank you. Assume we'll see you.
Could I just ask a quick question?
Sure.
Because I'd like to sort of feedback if I can, if you wouldn't mind. Is there a reason why you would oppose? Is that appropriate, or if it's not? It's good just to get feedback for us when we're designing, that's all. I don't want to put you on the spot, and if it's not appropriate, I can, I'll withdraw my question.
No, I'd have you withdraw your question at this point.
Mr. Chair, point of order, though, that's up to the alternate, well, to Mr. Nelson, whether or not he wants to. It's up to the individual, the chair. He has no say over that.
Maybe outside of the planning board.
We'll come out for the next session.
Yeah, well, maybe outside of a planning board process, we can have a chat, if you're willing to.
Yeah, I'm sure you'll find out.
It's nice to have feedback as we're designing, so.
Understood.
And I didn't mean to put you on the spot, or.
All righty.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. We'll see you in a while.
Okay.
Okay, next on the agenda is Maplewood and Vaughn Holding LLC and NIP Lot 6 LLC. Continuation of public hearing for an application, major site plan review at 2 Forbes Road, tax map R3, Lot 9-6, 175 Exeter Road, tax map R3, Lot 6, 177 Exeter Road, tax map R3, Lot 7, 181 Exeter Road, all in the B2 zone. Project consists of constructing two new industrial buildings, approximately 14,000 and 20,000 square feet, along with a 12,000 square foot addition on an existing industrial building on Lot 9-6. Existing houses and driveways on Lot 6, 7, and 8 will be removed, and the lots will be combined with Lot 9-6, and the boundaries will be adjusted into three new lots, one for each building. The applicant has requested a continuance to August 9th, 2016. Is there a motion?
So, second.
Any discussion?
Haven't we already done the boundary line adjustment?
We have.
We did, and that was a mistake in the public notice, and I think Sue is aware of it. We'll make that change for the next iteration.
Any other comments, questions, all in favor?
A question. How often can an applicant continue?
As many times as we allow.
Yeah.
They ask, and we vote.
It's mutually agreed to.
Okay.
Any other questions, comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion passes. Thank you. Next on the agenda is DDC Realty Trust.
Can I back up?
Sure.
We need to continue this to a date certain.
Yes.
Oh, you did?
We did.
Okay, did you read the rest of that? Okay, sorry, I was in parentheses.
Yes. All right, next is DDC Realty Trust, David Valkovic, trustee. Continuation of a public hearing for an application for subdivision at 125 Grant Road, tax map R4, Lot 44, in the R1 zone. The proposal is to subdivide the 8.01 acre lot into three lots. The lot with the existing house located on the corner of Grant and Ash Swamp Road will be 2.57 acres. Second lot located on Ash Swamp Road will be 2.3 acres, and the third lot located on Grant Road will be 3.14 acres. The full application is available for review at the planning office during normal business hours. I have in front of me an email to Diane from Christopher Berry, who was a representative of the applicant. Please accept this email correspondence as a request for an extension to the August Planning Board meeting, so the town's contracted wetlands agent may review the project as requested at the last Planning Board meeting. Please feel free to contact me further with any questions. So for the record, those of you that remember or that weren't here, we wanted Mark West to review the wetland line. That hasn't happened yet. We expect it to happen in the next week or so. So that's why we are continuing. So I will accept a motion.
I'll make a motion to continue the public hearing for an application for subdivision at 125 Grant Road, tax map R4, Lot 44, R1 zone, for DDC Realty Trust and David P. Valkovic, trustee, to the August 9th, 2016 meeting.
Thank you. Is there a second? Second by Janice. Any comments, questions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you all. Next on the agenda is a future land use continuance pursuant to RSA 675:6 and 675:7. Discussion, deliberation, and possible adoption by the Newmarket Planning Board regarding the future land use chapter as an amendment to the Town of Newmarket Master Plan. Amendment includes a future land use map with changes for a residential coastal protection district, continuing care retirement overlay district, assisted living overlay district, and Route 108 corridor overlay district, and recommendations related to zoning for economic development, a developer's guide, climate change, shoreland protection, stormwater management, property maintenance, and junkyards. So, we have closed the public hearing on this.
Would you get a letter?
Oh, yes. Would you please?
Would you like me to read it?
Everybody probably, the planning board members have the letter. Yes, please read it.
Yes, we received a letter on July 8th from Sean and Mary O'Shaughnessy, who live at 179 New Road. And I'll just review it quickly. Dear planning board members, we are writing in support of the zoning.
Hold on, let me stop.
Shouldn't we read this in the record? Because we had a letter last meeting that didn't get read into the record. It was just submitted as part of the record.
Oh, so we just submitted as part of the record?
Or do we have to go back and read the letter from last time?
Okay, it's really for the benefit of the public so that they know what the content is. They're welcome to.
No, I'm thinking, do we have to read the letter from last time too? That's all to be consistent.
I think to be consistent,
probably.
We should be consistent. But why don't we just summarize? There is a letter of support of the Residential Coastal Protection District from the O'Shaughnessys, right?
Okay,
and there's a copy in the rec. There'll be a copy in the rec. I think that's fair, Val. That's a good point.
Like to see a copy of it, they're more than welcome.
If anybody wants to see it, we have it here.
And what's the second letter?
So this is deliberation and a vote if we get to that point. So, Val, I know you had some suggested changes. Do we want to start? Everybody okay with starting with Val's suggested amendments?
So, I think everyone has a copy of my draft memo and the motion that I would propose for this evening. So just, you know, after assessing all the public input, speaking with other, in attending other meetings with that the town is involved with relative to the coastal protection efforts and aquifer protections. It would be my position that we should, at this point in time, actually remove the section on the residential coastal protection district, as we now have under the zoning recommendation section, and then amend other sections to incorporate some of those items within. Go through those.
Yeah, quickly. I think so, absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
So again, the whole section under the zoning recommendation of the residential coastal protection district would actually come out. Okay. We would rename the section currently shoreland protection measures to shoreland and water quality protection measures. Under that section, the second paragraph would come from paragraph one of the current RCPD, which states that the Newmarket Planning Board is part of its vision, housing and demographics, natural resources and water resources master plan chapter work has prioritized the protection of water quality in the Great Bay and other water resources. Additionally, risks of coastal flooding as a result of sea level rise necessitate actions that ensure the resiliency of structures that are adjacent to vulnerable areas. The coastal areas of Newmarket are particularly vital to the community and economic health as they offer a multitude of scenic and recreational areas that are attractive to residents and visitors. Continuing on, at the end of that section, we would take the original paragraphs 2 and 4 out of the RCPD, insert them at the end here, and as amended with these revisions. So that would read, the regulations should permit land uses which ensure the protection of the environmentally sensitive Great Bay and other critical resources, including drinking water aquifers, subject to potential saltwater intrusion or other negative impacts from large groundwater withdrawals, wetlands, steep slopes, and surface waters. This could be accompanied by limiting commercial, industrial, and high-density residential development in certain key areas of the town, adopting, updating ordinances and regulations for protection of groundwater resources, and minimizing erosion and other contributors of nutrients to non-point source pollution. Zoning changes would be intended to limit vulnerability of private municipal infrastructure from both tidal flooding due to increased frequency of major storm events and potential sea level rise scenarios, and overdevelopment or uses which could negatively impact groundwater resources. Additionally, due to the increased environmental vulnerabilities, innovative land use and planning techniques for limited impact development should be strongly encouraged. Zoning changes for increased road frontage, lot size, and setback standards, together with lower density and height restrictions, would help address protection of the important environmental resources and cultural aspects. So the premise of this is to take these goals of the town, if you will, and information and what we're getting from other reports, particularly with regards to water resources in the town, and having them apply across the town. It may, you know, our coastal watershed isn't just limited to what we had established as this residential coastal district. We've got, you know, properties that are feeding the Pasasset, the upland section of the Lamprey River, and it's all going into Great Bay. So this, by moving it under the stormwater and the stormwater section, renaming it, sorry, shoreline, and then renaming it to water quality protection measures, we can start looking at the entire town, where these critical resources are, and how to best protect them, if we need to modify and update any regulations. That's that section. Under the...
Val, can I just ask you a question about that?
Yeah.
So what about the sections on extending it to include first, second, and third order streams?
That's already in there.
That's still
that didn't get taken
that's
out.
It?
This was no, that was already under stormwater. I haven't changed anything under stormwater other than moving some sections from the RCPs, the Residential Coast Protection District, moving some of those paragraphs into this section.
Okay.
So that as we start to look at updating regulations and ordinances throughout the town, we can really look at all of the land areas of the town and not just, you know, what is currently R1 in, you know, off of New Road and off of Bay Road. We really should be looking at the town.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And
makes sense.
The chairman of the Conservation Commission had brought that up. Does that answer that question, Peter?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, under the stormwater management standards, which is under the other recommendations. The recommendation section, I work with Diane on this, so this really just got fine-tuned. I don't think there's really a change there. It's evaluate the minimum area soil disturbance requirement that triggers the application for town's stormwater regulations. Modify the regulations to encourage the use of low-impact development techniques to the maximum extent possible. Consider a maximum effective impervious cover requirement for new development, redevelopment, and ensure the regulations reflect the minimum design criteria for water quality, volume flow, groundwater recharge volume, and peak flow. So this now matches what prior motion had been made and adopted. It never got corrected in where we were at the last revision. And then under the open space design and other flexible subdivision methods, under the other recommendation section, I've taken a portion, a lot of that language comes from the original RCPD paragraph 4. And so adding it here, the section was low impact uses, which are characteristic of high quality neighborhoods with lower overall density, should be encouraged within these areas of the town, meaning critical resource areas if you read, you know, the prior paragraph. Such uses include, but are not limited to, single family housing, bed and breakfast, and family daycare. Increased road frontage, minimum lot size, reduced density, height, and setback standards. Mayor would also help address protection of the important environmental aspects within these areas. So we really should be thinking about open space design and flexible subdivision methods throughout the town. Again, not just in what we were thinking of a one particular district. And then finally, under the section of the zoning ordinance modifications for economic development, we would add the following paragraph after the section M2, M3 zoning districts. It would be in bold, the B2 east of railroad tracks. I've noted as the prior Blackwood TIF district, revert the existing B2 zone to the east of the railroad right-of-way and west of New Road back to residential use. The area zone B2 to the west of the right-of-way could be maintained as industrial commercial as they match the character of the existing industrial park on Forbes Road and have access via Route 108. This change in zoning will also affect the limited capacity of New Road and the limited access railroad bridge connecting it to Route 108 in southern New Market. Now, again, this has simply just moved it into what are the recommendations that came out from the Economic Development Committee, the Quas and the Connery reports. So it's in a totally different section of this master plan where it should be, because those were not the planning board recommendations, but the EDC recommendations. That's, if anyone has any questions on those.
Anybody have any questions?
Again, I haven't, I really have just taken information and put it into the different sections.
Questions, comments?
I think it's a great compromise, I mean, for all involved, and it's a fair document, and she just basically moved a few things around, and I think it's well done.
I agree with that. I have one question, Val, on the last one, the B2. Is there, this is what we always had a lot of public input on, a lot of discussion about. Is there any thought to still leaving that area so it could be commercially developed?
Well, I think that's up for the planning board to decide. This is simply to put into this chapter what the recommendations of the EDC are, and they're not necessarily the recommendations of the planning board. That's why I moved them to this chapter.
Okay, so that's the distinction.
Correct.
Okay.
I think it's up to the planning board whether or not they move forward to do any zoning changes.
Okay. Does anybody else have any questions, comments?
I have a couple questions focused on kind of the second page bolded paragraph from RCPV, paragraphs 2 and 4 that were included. I guess my first question is whether, so is open space design development included as part of limited impact development, or are those separate things?
Separate.
Well, they got moved into, if you, yeah, that section about the open space and limited impact development was also included as under open space and other flexible design. But it should be in both, because if it's all about stormwater management, there, it would be, it's typically better to use LIDs to be able to better regulate stormwater.
Sure. So I guess my comment would be, I mean, so first, I think in that paragraph, just one brief typo that usually is the overdevelopment of just making that one word, because otherwise it can be read differently.
Where are you? We're halfway down? Oh, okay.
Level rise scenarios and overdevelopment of that line. But if we're not kind of specifying this area for specific changes, saying we're going to explore further, I mean, there might be possibilities that when we explore, we have some type of kind of metric of what needs certain different regulations and what doesn't, and may have an overlay district, may not, I don't know what might come out of that. But I guess that my thought would be that, I mean, one is potentially adding the idea of open space design to the idea of LID there, but include, expanding it from should be strongly encouraged to just adding and further explored, with the idea that we could come out with something where there's a recommendation or encouragement, but it could end up being where, for example, open space or limited impact development is the default, and then the, a special use permit is required if you want to do traditional development, or that it might just be where we're not just looking to encourage it, but we're looking to make certain changes in certain areas. And so I think the language there could allow for more flexibility in terms of where we go with it as we explore it further.
So what's your recommendation?
So after should be strongly encouraged, just to add and further explored. And then innovative land use and planning techniques for limited impact development and open space preservation, or, and I mean, I'm open to, I mean, or even just more broadly, and conservation efforts or something along those lines. I don't have.
What's everybody else think? I mean, this is obviously Ezra's. I'm fine with it the way it is. Yeah, and further explored, if we want to add that to it, I have no problem with that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we really need to get too much more detail than that at this level.
I mean, or if it just said, instead of for, it was such as or something like that. I just don't want it to limit us when we go to the next step. If we have, want to do something that's not 100% under that, that we can't explore it. So I'm just looking for...
I think what you're really trying to say is that how you want this to read is limited impact development in other innovative land use and planning mm-hmm. techniques should be strongly encouraged.
And further explored.
Yeah, that would be. That sounds great to me. Can I make a statement too? I believe it's low impact development, not limited.
Sorry, low impact.
Everybody okay with the proposed changes? Val, are you okay with the proposed changes from Ezra? Okay.
And thanks for all your work on this as well. I can add that comment.
I just want to thank the committee for helping Dale, Roseanne, Diane.
I just add, I liked Val's comment about that we are going to be seeing, you know, there are several members of the town that are participating. UNH has a groundwater modeling study underway. So there's Newmarket's kind of the beneficiary. A lot of almost you know, sort of free information, free study that's going on town lands. We're going to be modeling groundwater. So I think it helps, if nothing else, for it to sensitize everybody to the issues that are facing the town. So I think Val's done a good job of sort of keeping this open enough, but, you know, having us all be looking to, you know, the future in terms of what changes will be necessary. We know we can't be totally static on the way we are currently zoned, and I think it's a good change to the the future chapter, and I think it's I like the language.
Any other comments? So it's a pleasure of the board.
I'd like to make a motion to amend the proposed future land use Town of Newmarket master plan dated April 22nd, 2016 in watermarked draft 06-14-2016, as discussed this evening on the new language and moving of the paragraphs as proposed this evening, dated July 8th, 2016.
There is a second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded by Dale, motion by Roseanne. Any discussion, further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? The ayes have it, 7-2-0.
Zero.
All righty, thank you. And thank you, Val, for your work.
Yep, great job, thank you.
Better end product. Onward. New old business. Discussion of design review. Rosie, I think this was your...
Yes. I don't know if everyone's available to get together. Peter and Ezra had discussed some interest in getting together, and maybe we could set a date tonight.
If it's not going to be a full thing, do you want to just find a time right after the meeting? And I mean, discuss a date and time and figure it out?
If Peter's available, sure. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We could discuss proceedings after this meeting. That would be great.
I just want to make sure that what I heard was an approval or an adoption, because I heard the amendment, but I wasn't sure that that was actually a motion to adopt the chapter.
That
may be a good point.
Yes.
You voted to amend it.
To adopt as amended.
And that includes Valerie's amendments and Ezra's.
And Ezra's.
So is there a resecond?
Ezra, second.
Ezra, resecond.
Second.
Okay.
All right, discussion. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Thank
you. Chairman's report. All right. So, in a previous meeting, we voted down in the site plan on Grape Street. The applicant has subsequently filed a lawsuit against the town. Our counsel, legal counsel, is now saying we should settle. So I don't know what the right avenue is. He's made an offer of settlement, the applicant.
The applicant's attorney has made an offer of settlement.
Our attorney.
It's been presented to us for consideration, so we need to probably have a meeting with legal counsel to discuss whether it's appropriate and whether the town wants to accept the agreement. Sorry, we need to.
Yeah, no, that's fine, because the issue is that.
It's not our agreement, it's their agreement at this point, their proposal.
We voted based on an opinion we received from our legal counsel, and it seems as though our legal counsel is backtracking from that opinion.
Well, I think basically, I'd like to make a motion that the planning board enter into a non-meeting with legal counsel to discuss the Grape Street suit.
I'm not so sure we need a motion for that. I think we need to do that. I think we need to.
We have to vote it all into.
On the agenda.
And that's what we need to do, is set a time and have him come in and talk with us.
Okay.
All right, so we'll accept that motion. Is there a second to Rosie's motion?
Because you'll vote to go into non-public at that time.
Right.
We don't need to.
So what the motion be then, not now?
We don't need to vote to go into non-public anytime the planning board desires to have a meeting with legal counsel. It's considered a non-meeting and it's not subject to the.
Okay. I just want you to stop further public discussion.
Okay.
Okay. All right, so that's great. So we can do that at a future date. Diane will get in touch with legal.
That's where I was going in, is we need to have a meeting with our attorney to find out what is going to happen or what we should do.
Legal guidance.
But so there's a letter from, I think the letter was actually signed by Mr. Chee.
Yes, and that has not yet.
I think we should not discuss anything else in the public.
All right, that's fine. I just didn't know whether everybody wanted a copy.
And I can make copies today to the planning board.
Just to planning board members, super.
All right, committee reports.
Well, this month's conservation committee is coming up Thursday, but reporting from the last time, there was a suggestion that in the future, in terms of master plan chapters, if we're thinking about creating a subcommittee, that what would be great is to formally invite the Conservation Commission to be part of that. They said that, especially on these types of things, they feel like that's kind of an area where they have expertise and would love to contribute and be as involved as they can be, sharing that with the planning board.
That's always a good idea.
And of course, I mean, all those meetings are open to the public anyway, so with you here, you know, you could just carry that over to them and let them know, so they're aware of it.
That's it.
Well, I was at the Stratford Regional Planning Transportation Advisory Committee last Friday, which they did a slide presentation just discussing potentially available funding opportunities for highway projects. So I just mentioned to Diane, it would be useful to me to get a little more knowledge to better represent Newmarket at those meetings, to know if we do have any road-related priorities for the town of Newmarket, so that I can sort of keep those in a perspective of the other things being discussed. So one of the items for discussion was that there is an increasing gap between the actual available amount of federal funds becoming available and projects that are being asked to be funded at the local level. It wasn't quite clear as to exactly why we weren't getting our full share of available public federal dollars, but I suspect part of that was just because of requirements for matching grants and matching money and coming up with the match to get some of those grants. But the Stratford Regional Planning Council is coming up with a new sort of planning framework that will be discussing how transportation projects are prioritized. So if those if transportation projects and highway projects intersect anywhere with the master plan, it would be helpful for me to just get a little bit more up to speed on that to better represent New Market at those meetings when it involves transportation. The regular policy committee meeting is this Friday, so I don't have anything new to report this month on that. That meeting hasn't happened yet.
Thank you. Go ahead, Ms. Nee.
Would the proposed, from UNH, the proposed road program, would that, the road surface management, would that be helpful to Peter?
Well, that's still, we did, I was aware of that.
Okay.
The New Market portion still has not been fully funded and approved, but that's still working its way through the channels based on the public meeting that we had a few months ago downstairs.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hoping to sort of keep my fingers on that. Obviously, you know, I went to that meeting saying that, you know, New Market has invested significant funds in its own water and sewer improvements, and that they're expecting to see the rest of that portion of that project happen. So they know that's on our priority list, that, you know, that shouldn't drop off of the funding scheme. Mm-hmm. But, you know, again, there's no guarantees if something else happens, because it's partly up to the legislature. But the 10-year state transportation plan has been passed, and pretty much, you know, that's all available online as to what those projects are. The thing that I keep going back and forth with this committee meeting is, you know, everybody shows up from the local municipalities and they discuss this sort of bold 10-year plan, but you never know, you know, I don't have enough to take back to say, okay, now there's a, you know, what are some additional pots of money, and does New Market have a set of priorities that, you know, something might bump up because some new monies are becoming available. So I'm just trying to figure out what's the best way where I can sort of align that, those opportunities with what may be discussed in New Market.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to mention that every two or three years we go through a process with the staff at the Stratford Regional Planning Commission, and the transportation planner will meet with the town administrator, myself, sometimes we include Rick Malosky, and we start to identify projects that are critical that the town should be pursuing. And with that input in the past anyway, they've incorporated that into the 10-year planning process. So what I wanted to suggest is this year, and when we go through that exercise again, we'd love to have Peter participate in that with us as sort of the liaison. Mm-hmm. With the Regional Planning Commission. And I also wanted to say that it's been many years since we updated our transportation chapter in the master plan. We just adopted the future land use section. So I'm looking ahead to the future and what should be our next topic. So I think that the transportation section is, you know, is one that's critical, because there is still some funding available to address issues, and perhaps that might be an area that we look to in the future for our next chapter to work on. So I was just going to put in a plug for that.
We need to let the dust settle a little bit. Go ahead, Val.
Can I just want to be clear on what Peter is on? So the 108 project that they're working on right now in the Durham side,
mm-hmm.
that the funding to bring that into New Market is not there. Is that what I'm hearing?
That's not correct. It is there.
The money
is there. It's in the plan.
Right.
And they're going out to bid next
okay.
winter.
So
it hasn't gone out to bid yet.
Okay. It's still part of the plan.
Yeah.
But there's other projects that could be included in the future on the 10-year plan.
Right.
But we need to be able to get them on the list so that they move up in priority.
Okay.
But that specific project that you're seeing underway now, the bids for the Durham portion have all been let and are underway.
Right.
None of the bids for the
okay.
New Market portion have been
process.
Underway. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, they said that's probably a November, December time frame that they're
year.
Looking to have those bids go out. So basically it got delayed by about a year.
Okay.
So the risk was, you know, something could happen within that year still that we don't know about. But every time it comes up, I remind everybody it's a priority for New Market.
the funding is capped. So if in a year's time the price goes up 10%, you know, the town will have to come up with any money beyond what they've committed. Yes?
That's, this, he's talking about a state project, doesn't have anything to do with the town.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, sorry.
The sidewalk project?
The sidewalk project is started officially.
We're talking about the North Main Street.
We're talking about the North Main Street.
And I bring it up only from the perspective that, you know, the town was the state was acquiring portions of private property for this project.
Right.
And basically threatening eminent domain if you didn't sell it to them. So it's like, okay, well, is it really going to happen?
It's supposed to happen next year, and it's on the list for priority funding. What happened was there was an appeal to the state project, to the water council, regarding the flooding impacts and so forth. I won't get into details. And that delayed the project for about a year.
Right.
But as Peter said, the Durham part is under contract.
We know that.
And that next year, we know that, obviously.
Takes an hour.
But the time schedule that DOT gave us at a meeting we had in February was next winter they were going to bid the new market piece, and the project would be completed in 2017.
Right. The only two things I wanted to touch on with that is, because Eric, to your point, this bike path south of New Market is the one we're managing, where funds were flowing through New Market, and that's where we had to come up with additional money. The project's being scaled back. That's where those kind of changes are happening on that. And also, I think the UNH, the UNH work that's being done to help evaluate our road priorities, that's
ongoing.
That's ongoing and should be pretty near completion. That's been ongoing for a while. My understanding is where.
Matt has any information. Of course, the Regional Planning Commission is working with UNH on that project as well.
Right. So that is a source that we should have an update of the plan that was done, 5 years ago, that was really never followed with the financial crash. But that's being reworked, and we're supposed to see that before too long.
Thank you.
A question, Peter. When you say transportation plan, does that include roads and sidewalks, or is it just roads?
Well, everything. Roads, bridges, railroad crossings,
okay.
Anything
trails.
That comes, trails. Well, transportation.
Yeah, bike.
Yeah, bike trails.
Transportation stuff, yeah.
There's all different pots of funding.
Oh, all right. So sidewalks would be
included. But we're talking anything that goes through the Department of Transportation with federal highway assistance is what Peter is referring
to. It
includes, has to be part of a 10-year plan.
Right. It includes, like, UNH, you know, Wildcat Coast bus service, so all the bus service, any metro service, that kind of thing.
Good.
Trains.
Anybody else? Any else? Committee reports or anything?
I'll just mention again that we did go, there was a subcommittee with, that's I'm part of, with two members of the school board and two members of the town council that went to, we went to Cape Elizabeth. The new superintendent for the town has come from Cape Elizabeth, where they have a one-town concept. And I think this got mentioned last time because it's come before the town council a couple of times, but we did get a chance to see how that is executed in Cape Elizabeth. It's very interesting. In general, the four of us came away thinking more that it's more integrated. We thought they might be more kind of nibbling at integration, but they have integrated substantially, and they think it makes a lot of sense. So I think that's something both the school board and the town council will be looking at. A lot of the work to be done, and I haven't talked with the town administrator recently, but you know, the new superintendent has been in place through July 1st, and that's part of when she has her feet underneath her a little bit, that's something that they're supposed to start for discussions.
Do they actually have two separate boards still? Do they have a school board and a
They do. They're town council form of government, so there's a lot of similarities. But they'll have, for example, a facilities person or
municipal.
Right, and I thought they might have people underneath some kind of leader that was confined to one side of the other town or school administration. But you know, for example, the finance person, they have somebody that does accounts payable. They have accounts payable. Right, and when they do it that way, they make sure the software is the same, so that they have one set of software, and And, you know, what the comment they will make is that once you've done it that way, you wonder why would you ever do it any other way?
Yep.
And I think that's...
How long has that been implemented there? How long have they been doing this?
They started it back in the 70s, but...
Oh, wow.
But remember, in New Hampshire, and the town administrator had some, testified to some degree, New Hampshire just changed the law to allow that at the beginning of this year. So we're only allowed to do what we're allowed to do, and that was one of the things you weren't allowed to do. But now we are.
Yeah, you just get economies of scale and reduction in redundancy.
You know, greater expertise, too. You have somebody that is managing more, and it works that way, so...
Makes a lot of sense. Anybody have anything else? Diane, do you have anything?
No, all set. Thank you.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.